Good morning. We will start with our first hymn. It'll be How Great Thou Art. If you can put the words up for us. Lessons. Thou art.
Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen.
Today I'll be reading Psalms 121, my grandma's favorite scripture. I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from my Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber or sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore.
Dear Lord God, as we come to you and we hold this service here in honor of the memory of our sister in Christ, Leslie May Hooper. Lord, we know that you are absolutely sovereign. We just want to thank you, Lord, that we were able to enjoy the time with Leslie that we had, knowing, Lord God, that she was a gift in our lives. Yet, Lord, the time here upon earth that she had was determined by you. As David had written in Psalm 139, your eye saw my substance being yet unformed, and in your book they all were written. The days were fashioned for me when as yet there were none of them. Lord God, you had determined how long Leslie would be here among us. And it was when it was time, Lord God, for you to take her home. And Lord, even though we experience sorrow right now, we know that there was blessed joy as she was being welcomed into your celestial kingdom on the day that she departed. Lord, I just pray that we may take comfort in this. And Lord, I just pray that there will be this assurance and this peace, Lord God, that we receive from you and from your word on this occasion. And it's in Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay. I'm going to be singing In the Garden. It was one of my grandma's favorite hymns.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Well, thank you, Sophia and Olivia. That was very beautiful, by the way. I'm going to open my remarks here this morning from this non-obituary to offer some personal reflections on Leslie. Michelle stated very emphatically that there was not to be an obituary. So that is not what this is. Leslie was also adamant that we were not to have a funeral or a memorial service for her. So this is not a memorial service. If word somehow gets back to her about this, shall we say, gathering, well, they can just tell her that it was not a memorial service, just for the record. I'm sure there's angels within earshot. Somebody can deliver the message to her. Rather, it's a time of remembrance, commemoration, a celebration of her life. You know, Leslie's gone, but she's still telling everybody off. Besides, Leslie, I would tell you this, the service isn't for you, it's for the rest of us, so get over it. Enjoy your current accommodations. So I'm going to go to this paragraph that Andy, boy, she reaches back into history, doesn't she, on this, if you go through this to her parents. But I'm going to pick up with this paragraph where Leslie came to the ministry back in the early 70s. She actually came to our church first back in 1972. And Andy writes how Les seeks out and finds Christian spiritual guidance in the form of Pastor Fred Hilst, my father, at the nearby Bible Tabernacle. And this turns out to be a major turning point in Leslie's life. Under Pastor Fred's guidance and others with whom she becomes close friends, Les becomes highly involved with all the workings needed in the outreach church, in an outreach church like the Bible Tabernacle, which, by the way, is an understatement. From doing the bookkeeping, picking up neighborhood children for Sunday school, teaching children Sunday school, helping out at summer camp, and the list really goes on. Along with working to help my mother in the office, she produced the Sunday bulletins, the quarterly prayer letter that we would put out. She was one of our drivers, as was pointed out. I can remember back in the day having these two 15-passenger Dodge vans that were green. In the center, it was white on top, and the lower panel was white. One was automatic, the other was a stick shift, and Leslie drove both. And she was just doing everything. She helped my wife, Gaylin, make her junior high graduation dress. And then later, my sister, Lori, she made her wedding dress. So she really did a little bit of everything. She was truly a Jill of all trades. My father referred to Leslie as my girl Friday. She belonged to a generation that learned to be self-sufficient. She didn't just sit at home with her nose buried into an iPhone. She was out doing things. Leslie was 10 years my senior and like a big sister to me. She set me straight a time or two. As Andy points out, Les spoke her mind, which she did, but she also watched out for me. She had my back. She wrote me in a few years ago to tutor Michelle in pre-calculus. Were you in high school or college at the time? I don't remember exactly. I don't think I really helped her out very much, but I pocketed $30. So, okay. Andy mentions her love for camping, and being outside there and backpacking, hiking, whitewater rafting, kayaking. A few years ago, we were watching a live news broadcast showing this enormous gush of water, about 60 feet high. Some stupid idiot ran over a fire hydrant. And it was just flooding Sepulveda Boulevard, creating a traffic mess. So Leslie shows up the next day, and she tells us that she pulled into the Getty Center overflow parking lot, and she was just trying to turn around, and she backed up into this fire hydrant. Ah, so you were that moron. Yeah, she laughed, that was me. You know, that was a huge pickup truck that she drove, and she didn't even realize that she hit anything. Next thing, she sees this water coming down from everywhere, and she's, where's all that rain coming from? There's no clouds. She didn't really fool me, being the nature lover that she was. She wanted to create an LA version of Old Faithful Geyser. So she decided to add another fountain to the Getty Center. With the river that was flowing down Sepulveda Boulevard, she could have pulled out her kayak and rowed home. In Psalm 121 that Olivia had read, this is one of those psalms which offers reassurance, along with Psalm 91 and the 23rd Psalm. And the psalmist writes, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? Some commentators point out that Pilgrims who were about to embark on a trip to one of the annual feasts in Jerusalem would take precautions because the mountain passes were treacherous. They might encounter robbers or other predators. There were leopards, there were wolves that were known to inhabit the area at the time. However, the mountains could also serve as a symbol of security and stability, a picture of God who is our rock and one who is a place of refuge. And so the psalmist reflects this in verse 2, "My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth." The mountains which portray strength, they remind us of God, the ultimate power and the one who is the creator of absolutely everything. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord watches over you. Other translations render that as he is your keeper. We see over here in Psalm 91, where it begins, "He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust." And then we also have the opening of the 23rd Psalm, in which David wrote, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." He is our ultimate caretaker. He's the great shepherd. Our Lord Jesus really echoed David's thoughts regarding this carried shepherd in John 10. And in verse 11, Jesus stated, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. There's no better shepherd than that. In verse 15, he stated, "I lay down my life for the sheep." And as we move on to verse 27, he says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life." That's a very significant point. I give them eternal life. "And they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand." He is the one who is our ultimate caretaker. He's the great shepherd. And his sheep will never be destroyed. They will never be removed from his care. Over in John chapter 11, following the death of a dear friend of his by the name of Lazarus, he was comforting Lazarus' sister Martha, who was rather distraught. And in verse 25, Jesus offered these very memorable words, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." Christ himself has the power over death. He is the one who's the creator of all life. Over in Luke 20, we have this exchange that Jesus was having with the Sadducees, who did not believe either in life after death, the resurrection, nor supernatural beings such as angels. And in a hypothetical scenario, they talk about a woman who married all seven of these brothers, which was common in a levirate marriage back in Old Testament times. They all widowed her, and then she dies herself. And so their question is, whose wife will she be when she gets into heaven? And I can imagine his colleagues in the background just chuckling at this question that is posed to Jesus. But his response was very telling. In the 34th verse of Luke 20, Jesus says that the sons of this age marry and are given in marriage. But those who are counted worthy to attain that age and the resurrection from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, nor can they die any more, for they are equal to the angels and are sons of God. And this is an important point because we don't become angels when we die. Angels are distinct celestial beings which are created by God for his service, and in the discharge of their duties, they serve saints. But humans, those who belong to the Lord, do not become angels after death. We then become children of the resurrection. And just like the angels, we never die. We then become eternal. Our lives then are everlasting. But then the Lord continued in verse 37. Even Moses showed in the burning bush passage taken from Exodus 13 that the dead are raised when he called the Lord, and this was the passage that Jesus cites, the God of Abraham, he's the God of Isaac, and he is the God of Jacob. And the Lord uses that to say, for he is not the God of the dead, but of the living, for all live to him. So he points out that Abraham, that Isaac, that Jacob, the ancestors of the Israelite people, they were still alive. Our Lord clearly demonstrated this point earlier during the Transfiguration when he appeared with Moses and Elijah, having a conversation with them. I would love to have been a fly on the wall for that meeting. They were alive and conscious, not in a state of repose. And so those who have gone on are living. And Paul, over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, touches on this very issue when he says in verse 4, for we who are in this tent groan, referring to these bodies, because we're burdened. Not because we want to be unclothed or just be rid of it, and as you age, it gets to be that way, but rather further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. I love that expression. That mortality may be swallowed up by life. And then in verse 8, he writes, we are confident, yes, well pleased, rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. We are then present with the Lord on the day that we die. Jesus revealed this when he was on the cross. There were two thieves that were crucified with him. Both of them were given Jesus smack, and then one of them changed his mind. His attitude shifted as he knew he was facing his death. He wasn't getting off that cross. And so he said to his buddy over on the other side in Luke 23, verse 40, do you not even fear God, seeing you're under the same condemnation? We indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. We're getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. And then he turned to Jesus and he said, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus gave him this answer. Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise. Today you will be with me in paradise. The Lord also gave us some insight in the parable that he told in Luke chapter 16, which is famously known as the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. And focusing on the poor man Lazarus, who had absolutely nothing, when he was passed away, it says in verse 22 of Luke 16, so it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. He was then carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. This passage offers the clearest insight as to what happens to our soul at the moment of death. Our God dispatches angels to escort us to heaven. Isn't that nice? Sort of like sending somebody over to LAX to pick you up at the airport and bring you in. Our souls don't simply float into the abyss of space. We receive an escort into God's heavenly kingdom. This whole idea of Abraham's bosom, we can get some idea of that when we look at what transpired at the Lord's Supper, at the Last Supper, rather. And John, who was leaning next to Jesus, we read in John 13:23. Now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples, whom he refers to as the one whom Jesus loved. I'm just one of his disciples who Jesus loved. He didn't want to draw attention to himself. But it says how he was leaning against Jesus' bosom. That was the way they ate. Not as Da Vinci's painting portrays them sitting on chairs at a table, but rather they reclined in the ancient Mideastern fashion and they ate with their fingers. And so he would have kind of been up against Jesus' chest. And that's the picture that's given to us of Lazarus as he is taken to the head of the table to sit with the father of the Jewish people, Abraham. He's there to enjoy a heavenly banquet in a seat of honor. And the Lord in John chapter 14 offered these words of comfort to his disciples, saying, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." I love that. I go to prepare a place for you. The Lord is being personal there. "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." I will come again. He's going to come and take us home to be with him. Those who have already died are simply getting a head start, a jump on the rest of us. They've already entered into eternal glory. Leslie's already there, but not by virtue of her good works. No, but rather grace. Grace is the only way to secure a spot in heaven. And that's because God is holy, absolutely holy. To live with him in his kingdom, you must be as holy as he is. The Lord Jesus said in Matthew 5:48, "You shall be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect." You may be thinking after hearing these words, "Oh, stink, my goose is cooked. I'll never make it. I'm a wretch." But here's the thing. God the Father sent his Son, Christ Jesus. God in human form, God personified, to do for us what we are incapable of doing for ourselves. He lived the perfect life in thought, in word, and in deed. And God requires us to live that perfect life. Jesus did that for us, and then he also became our sacrifice, taking our sin and consequently our punishment upon himself. Going back to the words of that thief, "This man has done nothing wrong." Pilate had said earlier, "I find no fault in him." And I don't think they realized just how right they were. Therefore, when I'll say I place my faith in Christ Jesus as my Lord and Savior, knowing that he died for my sin and then rose again, God grants me his grace by exchanging my sin for his righteousness. Because Christ Jesus took that upon himself. Thus, he makes me eligible for heaven. Paul wrote this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 20, saying, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you, on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Be made right with him. Be brought into fellowship with him. Restore that union with him. For he made him," that is, the Father made Christ Jesus, "the one who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." We assume the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. And that is why you need Christ in order to get into heaven. And this is what Leslie did. She trusted in Christ as her Lord and Savior. And just as the criminal on the cross, who had a change of heart, and he asked Jesus, "Remember me, remember me." His attitude was that of the publican whom Jesus had spoke about on another occasion in Luke chapter 18, who came to the Lord in prayer saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. The publican was despised. He was a traitor. He collected taxes for the Romans. And yet this is how he came to the Lord, as opposed to the Pharisee who was gloating about his righteousness, his good works, his generosity, his sacrifice, his obedience to God's word. The publican just said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus said he went home justified. To be justified means to be declared righteous by God. And when he asked the Lord, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, he received grace. Paul, in speaking about salvation in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 4, he wrote, but God who is rich in mercy. I love those words. God who is rich in mercy. Because of his great love with which he loved us. Even when we were dead in trespasses, in our iniquities, in our sin, he made us alive together with Christ. And he emphasizes, by grace you have been saved. He raised us up together, and he made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I love the way he words this in the past tense. It's as though it is something which has already occurred. It is already a done deal. As soon as we receive his grace, we have a place in heaven. That in the ages to come, he might show us the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. That's Leslie's experience right now. For by grace you have been saved through faith. Grace is what saves us. Faith is how we appropriate that grace. It's not of yourselves. Rather, it's the gift. Salvation is the gift of God. It's not of works, not of effort. Lest anyone should boast or take credit. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Good works really are the result of salvation. They're not something that we do for salvation. In Ephesians 1:13, Paul had written earlier, in him, that is in Christ Jesus, you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel, the good news of your salvation. This is how you receive it. In whom also, having believed, upon belief, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. The Romans, they would apply a seal to a document as a sign of authenticity, authority, and ownership. It was something that could not be tampered with. There was a seal that was placed over the tomb where Jesus had been buried, and anyone breaking it, it would result in the death penalty. And we're sealed by God with his Holy Spirit. Your salvation then is official. Christ assumes authority and ownership then of your life. And Paul continues that he is the guarantee of our inheritance. He guarantees our inheritance. That's what we have in the Lord. There's no in-between cycle. There's no purgatory. There's no concern for any of that. We are sealed by God. Our inheritance is guaranteed until the redemption of the purchased possession to the praise of his glory. We are the purchased possession, purchased by his blood. And the redemption that he speaks of is when he takes us home to be with him. And we see this description by Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Where Paul wrote these words of reassurance to believers who were feeling anxious and in despair over their circumstances. And he writes in verse 13, but I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. God will bring with him. Leslie is already there. She is with the Lord. When he returns, she is going to be with him. She's going to be part of that entourage. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. So there is a sequence, a rapid sequence of events which will transpire when this occurs. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel and with the trumpet of God. This kind of sounds like the military sounding of a charge by the cavalry when this glorious event is going to take place and he's putting us on notice and calling us up. The dead in Christ will rise first, that is, their bodies will be taken up. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. The word caught up is the Greek word harpazo, which means to be snatched away, and it's also where we get the word rapture. They will be caught up by the Lord to meet him in the clouds in the air, and thus shall we always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. I want to circle back to the epilogue in Psalm 121. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over you. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Hi, everyone. First, I wanted to say I may not be able to do it. First, I wanted to say thank you to Peter and for the Bible Tabernacle. My family has a lot of history here. In fact, yesterday when my sister and I were here, we were downstairs looking at, they used to do summer camps, and my dad used to take these big pictures of all the kids at the summer camp, and I think I was 5 years old in one of the pictures downstairs. And so my faith started here. My mom sounds like it got strengthened here. I believe it started probably in childhood, but by the time she got here under the tutelage of Pastor Fred, which was Peter's father, clearly, as you heard, she loved this church and this is her heart. So this is the only place that would ever be the place that would be considered to hold my mom's service. And Peter, you're the only pastor that I would ever ask to do this, and I thank you. And Michael, who helped me with this program, I changed it several times. He made so many adjustments, and he was amazing, and I just wanted to say thank you, Michael, for all the phone calls and the help. I really appreciate it. Made this process better for me. As Peter touched on, my mom was very clear she did not want a funeral. Originally, this started out as, I just want to come to church on Sunday at my mom's favorite church, and I want to sit here with my sister and my kids and just be present. And then it morphed into, actually, this is pretty much a service for my mom, and it's fine. It's a beautiful celebration of a beautiful life, and I think she would be happy with it. Everything is her favorite. She loved old school hymns, so the hymns, the songs are her. Probably 2 weeks before she passed and we were talking, I asked her, you know, what is your favorite scripture? What are your favorite hymns? And so that's what this service has been about. Even down to the little tissue and chapstick packs in the back. If you hung around my mom much, you knew that she always had tissue in her bra and she had her chapstick with her. So that's why, that's the meaning behind those. And as far as you can imagine, or maybe you have if you've had to lay somebody to rest, but even trying to find the perfect picture, you know, I just wanted the perfect picture. So what a beautiful representation this picture is of my mom. And in trying to find something for the, at first I didn't want a picture on the program. I was like, that's too funeral-y. We don't want to do that. And I was like, well, then maybe we'll do something that just shows how much she loved the outdoors. And so this picture just made me smile. So if anyone's wondering, gosh, that's a strange picture for the funeral program, that's why, because it's not supposed to be a funeral anyway, right? This just shows another side of my mom, the one who loved the outdoors and the free-spirited one. She did live a grateful life, and her faith was very strong. The last 6 years since her diagnosis with the cancer was very tough, but I tell you, she showed extreme grace and dignity through it all, every step of it, from the worst parts to the triumphs. There were triumphs as well. And she would say to me, my life's in God's hands. And so her faith really helped me also. I want to say thank you to the family and friends, for everyone who's reached out and helped. Big shout out to my aunt. I just wanted to say thank you, Auntie Andy. She put together the beautiful photos back there. She wrote the history on my mom's, and she was also the one that kept just telling me, Michelle, it's gonna be okay. You know, I was stressing over the picture. I'm stressing over this and that, you know, because everything's just gotta be right. And she's like, Michelle, it's gonna be okay. So I appreciate that. And if I really speak of my mom's last days, especially the last year, which was the hardest. Thank you, Auntie Andy, because you were in the trenches with me. So my mom, I remember her saying, well, I don't know what God has in store. She's like, I don't know why he would have me go out like this. You know, when she was using her cane and stuff, it just wasn't her, right? She was an outdoors woman, so. I have a lot of assurance now that she truly is at peace. When I was looking for a poem, this one really struck me, representative of my mom and how she would feel. She was very matter of fact, and definitely didn't mince her words, and you always knew where you stood with her. And so this poem apparently is an anonymous poem, and I did change the ending of it a little bit to, I thought, gear towards my mom's belief, and I'll read that. If you want to look on the back of your bookmark, that's there. I am free. Don't grieve for me, for now I'm free. I'm following the path God laid for me. I took his hand when I heard his call. I turned my back and I left it all. I could not stay another day to laugh, to love, to work, or to play. Task left undone must stay that way. I found my peace at the close of day. If my parting left a void, then fill it with remembered joy. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss, ah yes, these things I too will miss. Be not burdened with times of sorrow. I wish you the sunshine of tomorrow. My life's been full, I savored much. Good friends, good times, a loved one's touch. Perhaps my time seemed all too brief. Don't lengthen it now with undue grief. Open your heart to God and share in my belief. He called me home. He has set me free. And I believe she really is free from this world, free from the cares of this. And as much as I would love to say she's watching over me and she's visiting me, I know her soul is separated from me now, from all of us. But I do have absolute faith that I will see her again. Thank you.
I would ask you all to sing along with me. We're going to sing Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secure. As long as life endures, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. His grace that brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God praise than when we first begun.
Our most gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to you again, thanking you, Lord, for the time that we could hold this commemoration, the celebration of Leslie's life. The psalmist gave us these words in Psalm 116 when he wrote, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." That would be precious, Lord God, because they are welcomed into your presence. They are there. Lord, how we just thank you for this marvelous comfort, this reassurance, this knowledge that this world is not our only hope. There is a hope which lies beyond. Even King Solomon wrote in Ecclesiastes that he has placed eternity in the hearts of men. It's present. We have this consciousness of life beyond the grave because, Lord, we were created in your image and after your likeness and for the purpose of enjoying eternal fellowship with you. Lord, we just thank you for the time that Leslie could be with us, the contribution that she made to the lives of those in her family, her friends, her ministry, and most of all, Lord God, to you. And Lord, we know that she would have been able to say upon her passing, "As for me, I will see your face in righteousness. I shall be satisfied when I awake in your likeness." And so, Lord, we commend the soul of Leslie into the eternal and the loving care of her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and into the glory of her Heavenly Father, where she will enjoy your presence for all eternity. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That is the conclusion of our service. I'm looking to Michael here to, or is that going to be Kathleen to play? Anyway, thank you, everyone, for attending.
See my sin upon